More than one-third of American adults don't get enough sleep on a regular basis, and chances are you're one of them if you're watching this video. There are lots of different sleep disorders that affect people, but there's a very common one that often gets overlooked, as many people don't even realize it affects them. Why? Because the effects are subtle and lingers under the radar. That's what makes it the stealthiest sleep vampire of all, something called delayed sleep phase disorder. In order to understand how this works, let's understand how our sleep is regulated. There are two main processes that regulate our ability to consolidate our sleep. What does it mean to consolidate our sleep? Essentially, it's the ability for us humans to dedicate one block of our 24-hour day just for sleep, as opposed to having to break it up into multiple sleep episodes. So think of one block of sleep as a sleep episode, for example, going to sleep at 9 p.m. and then waking up at 6 a.m. So your sleep is regulated by many things, but the two biggest factors are one, your sleep homeostat, and two, your circadian rhythm. Let's talk about your sleep homeostat. This is your brain's version of a thermostat, but instead for sleep. When you're awake, the hypothalamus part of your brain secretes something called orexin, which is a chemical that makes you alert. It circulates in your brain during wakefulness and virtually disappears during non-REM sleep. Also, the accumulation of adenosine in your brain is the main biochemical process of lulling you to sleep. So the longer you're awake, the more adenosine accumulates in the brain, and that's what makes you tired. Once you fall asleep, the drive for sleep dissipates as the night progresses. So the further you are along in your sleep episode, the drive for sleep decreases. And the further you are into your sleep episode, the percentage of time you spend awake slightly increases, for example, tossing and turning, or perhaps looking at the clock or something. So you spend slightly more time being in the awake phase the closer you are to the end of the sleep episode. Now, let's look at the other major factor that regulates your sleep, your circadian process, which is driven by your circadian pacemaker, aka the circadian clock. It's located in the suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus, right next to the optic chiasm. The optic chiasm is the collection of nerves that senses light from the environment. Think of these nerves as an extension of your eyeballs. The percentage of time that young, healthy people are awake during a scheduled 8-hour sleep episode will vary by the time of day. In other words, sleeping 8 hours during the day is not the same as sleeping 8 hours at night. When it comes to circadian rhythm in humans, the peak drive for wakefulness actually occurs very late in the evening, around 8, 9, 10 p.m., just before most people's bedtime. Then, the time that the circadian pacemaker sends off the strongest drive for sleep is actually near dawn, just before when most people wake up in the morning. Some might say, well, that doesn't really make sense now, does it? Shouldn't our circadian clock tell us to be sleepy in the evening and be wakeful in the morning? So why does it happen like this? The circadian clock is set up in our brains like this because its purpose is to facilitate our ability to remain awake for 16 hours because the drive for wakefulness increases as the day progresses, even though we have this other drive that competes against it, meaning our sleep homeostat. So remember, with the sleep homeostat, we build up an increasing drive for sleep as the day progresses. But when it comes to the circadian clock, as the day progresses, it increases the drive to stay awake and actually peaks at the end of the day. This is why many mammals will have a burst of energy around sunset in order to prepare for the nighttime hours. And we're very similar in that regard. If you think back to the caveman times, it's like making sure all of the day's tasks are completed before the sun goes away. But obviously, we no longer live in caveman times, but this part of our brain still thinks that we do. And this contributes to us having a lot of circadian rhythm sleep disorders. If we use light exposure to stimulate our eyeballs and therefore stimulate our suprachiasmatic nucleus and shift our circadian clock so that the peak drive for wakefulness occurs during the time that we're trying to fall asleep, like around 11 p.m. or midnight, it becomes very easy to fall into that habit. And in that case, we'll have likely difficulty falling asleep at a reasonable hour. And this is what happens with delayed sleep-wake phase disorder. When you look at both this circadian rhythm and the sleep homeostat together, the interaction of these two processes helps to glue the sleep episode together so that we can maintain a consolidated part of sleep different than most other mammals in that we mostly don't take a little cat naps throughout the day or the night. Instead, we have this long marathon duration of sleep, typically 8 hours or so, and then a long marathon of being awake, typically 16 hours. So our circadian rhythm is driven by our circadian pacemaker, which is located in the suprachiasmatic nucleus in our hypothalamus. This also drives many other physiological processes like core body temperature and melatonin secretion, which peaks during the night hours. Our intrinsic circadian pacemaker is very close to being on a 24-hour cycle. Our circadian rhythms are normally synchronized with a 24-hour day by the light-dark cycle, but our timing of onset of melatonin release is genetically determined. The interval between the onset of melatonin release to the time of our regular bedtime at night is typically 4 or 5 hours, but that time frame depends on the individual based on our genetics. So if you typically go to sleep at 10 p.m., your pineal gland is starting to secrete melatonin around 5 p.m. And after 8 hours of sleep, wake-up time is around 6 a.m. These are the morning types, but people have different genetics. Some people might not have their melatonin secretion until later than 5 p.m. And if you try to go to bed before you have that melatonin circulating in your brain, you're probably not going to be able to fall asleep for the night. If we rewind the clock and go back to a time before we had artificial light, like 200 years ago, melatonin would have started rising around sunset. In that instance, this peak drive for wakefulness that occurs before sunset would have been happening in the afternoon, but now with artificial light, we've pushed our circadian system to later on in the evening, which means our melatonin secretion is happening later in the night. So with artificial light, the melatonin secretion is being shifted to later at night, and some people, most of them unaware of this, have something called delayed sleep phase syndrome, DSPS, which is also known as delayed circadian phase disorder. In this condition, the timing of the sleep episode occurs later than desired and is associated with difficulty falling asleep and difficulty waking up on time. So it's no wonder that when they're forced to wake up at an early time to go to school or to go to work, it's no wonder that they experience a lot of daytime sleepiness. And so they're tired all day. And then guess what? When it's time to go to bed at a decent hour, despite being tired all day, they have a hard time falling asleep because the cycle is repeating itself. This is a syndrome or disorder that has been recognized decades ago. These people are often labeled by the early risers as being lazy, but of course, that's not really what's going on here. This is actually a fairly common problem, and they're more likely to have frequent absenteeism, frequent loss of productivity, disruption to work or school activities, disruption to social life or leisure activities, and disruption to family life or home responsibilities. And that's hardly surprising because they're essentially sleep deprived, like all the time, and for good reason. So for people who have this condition, if you force them to sleep at normal times, for example, if you say, look, just go to bed at 10 p.m. and wake up at 6 a.m., your body will adjust over time. This has actually been looked at in a sleep lab. They usually only end up sleeping about 25 to 30% of the night. And this reveals the fact that they're really unable to sleep at this earlier circadian phase, even when they're significantly sleep deprived. So instead of fixing the problem, forcing them to shift their sleeping hours earlier only worsens the problem. The best way to fix the problem is sort of threefold. One is to adjust their sleep schedule, if possible, but that's not always feasible because people have certain school hours or work hours or whatever. The second thing is to avoid artificial light after the sun sets as much as possible. And the third thing is to strategically take supplemental melatonin. More and more artificial light is being used over the recent years. Even reading from a light-emitting device like a phone or an iPad in the evening hours, this results in huge suppression of melatonin release in the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And this effect can take place over days. For example, if you're spending hours looking at these devices in the evening, and then you do that for 5 days in a row, circadian rhythms are shifted later at night by about an hour and a half. So our exposure to evening light for many people will shift their circadian rhythm so that they feel very awake at night, like 9 p.m., 10 p.m., 11 p.m., and often don't fall asleep before 1 or 2 a.m. Another thing that can contribute to this delay in our circadian rhythm is irregularity in the timing of when we sleep and when we wake up. And this is why getting into a regular sleep routine is important for so many people. Those who are on irregular sleep schedules tend to have less sleep during the nighttime hours and tend to spend more time or more sleep is spent as compensatory daytime sleep, meaning they spent more of their day taking naps compared to those who maintained a more regular sleep schedule. Also, regular sleepers tend to have a much earlier timing of their onset of melatonin secretion. Now, just because someone goes to bed routinely at 2 a.m., that doesn't mean they automatically have delayed sleep-wake time disorder. Half of these people who look like they have delayed sleep-wake phase disorder with a delayed phase of the onset of melatonin secretion actually have a normal phase. But they have something else going on that is driving them to go to bed later. Now, this could include things like excessive stress or anxiety or any other number of issues that may come up that causes them to go to bed later. So, for example, this could include things like playing video games or watching TV or scrolling TikTok until 2 a.m. Well, if you're not going to sleep until 2 or 3 or 4 in the morning, of course you're going to be tired if you have to wake up at 6 in the morning. So people can have a pattern that looks like delayed sleep-wake phase disorder, but they may not actually have an underlying circadian rhythm problem. Maybe it's excessive stress and anxiety, maybe it's insomnia or something else. Now, we can also have an altered light period that disrupts our ability to maintain normal synchronization. This was first discovered in 1951, so individuals living within the Arctic Circle may have differences in the timing of their sleeping and waking at different seasons of the year. It's based on the fact that sunlight and artificial light suppresses melatonin secretion. It is well proven that we actually need to sleep during the dark hours if we want to maximize our growth, as well as maximize the other benefits of restorative sleep. Now look at this example. These are preterm newborns in a neonatal intensive care unit. Now, normally they're kept in continuous light because it's easier for the nurses to monitor them carefully. So they're constantly in the light, but in this study, researchers covered their eyes for 12 hours at night. They did this for 21 days straight. This actually accelerated their body weight gain and allowed them to be discharged from the hospital sooner. They also had better oxygen levels. So the timing of our exposure to the light-dark cycle is important for timing of our sleeping and waking in regard to synchronization of many different circadian rhythms that can have major effects on our motor development, cardiovascular health, and more. So getting at least 7 to 8 hours of sleep during the nighttime is ideal, although the exact ideal time frame for any given person is going to vary. And if you want more on the latest and greatest tips on getting better sleep and having more energy, check out the link I put in the description below. And thanks for watching.